Good morning. Let's start with the AIIMS questions, anesthesia and critical care mostly. So this time we had quite number of questions related to critical care, trauma, CPR. Okay, let's straight away start with the first question. Metabolic acidosis with normal anion gap is seen in all except salicylate poisoning, diarrhea, proximal RTA, pancreatitis. So it will be salicylate poisoning. You know that anion gap is sodium concentration minus chloride and bicarbonate concentration, and normally it is around 8 to 16, average is around 12. Now in metabolic acidosis, either anion gap will be increased or anion gap will be decreased, or anion gap can be normal also. So where the anion gap is maintained, means does not increases, will be the situation which is very much clear from this equation, that if bicarbonate decreases and there occur parallel increase in chloride, so anion gap is going to remain normal. So what are the conditions where although the bicarbonate decreases in the body, but there occur parallel increase in chloride maintaining the normal anion gap? And these conditions are diarrhea, where there is a bicarbonate loss from the gut, it will be compensated by increased chloride. Same with all gut related other enterostomies, ileostomies, colostomies, renal diseases, renal tubular necrosis, obstructive uropathies, chronic pyelonephritis. So kidney loses bicarbonate, but it is compensated by equal rise in chloride. Or if you are giving hydrogen or ammonium chloride, that again all compensated by increase in chloride. So all these are the conditions where anion gap is going to remain normal. And obviously in other conditions where there is no compensation, anion gap is going to increase. And these conditions are diabetic ketoacidosis, there occur accumulation of metabolites which can increase the pH, I mean make pH more acidic. Or ketoacidosis due to starvation, or lactic acidosis, accumulation of lactic acid, which is quite common in anesthesia. In fact, the most common acidosis that we see in anesthesia is lactic acidosis, and the reason for that lactic acidosis is simply shock, hypotension. So that's the most common condition that we encounter in anesthesia. Similarly, accumulation of salicylate in salicylic poisoning is going to increase the anion gap. Or same way methanol and ethylene glycol poisoning, and same way in renal failure where kidney is not able to excrete anions like sulfate or phosphate, so they will get accumulated, increasing the anion gap. Anion gap may remain normal in case of hypoalbuminemia and multiple myeloma. These are the two conditions where anion gap is going to remain normal. Question number 2. The color of 22-gauge cannula, definitely a very practical question. And obviously if you have really done the internships, so this question should be very easy. If you have genuinely done your internships, all of you must have used cannulas. So the color code for the cannulas is, the largest usually available is 14-gauge, although in some places you may find 12 gauge also, but that is rare. But yes, it is there. White color is for 12 gauge, that is occasionally used at some places you will see. But these cannulas are very common, 14 gauge orange cannula, a big size, you all must have used in emergency resuscitations in your casualty postings. Then gray is 16 gauge, that is again very very commonly used, very often used. And 18 gauge is green. Again, all of you must have seen pink for normal. If you don't want resuscitation, then just cannula is used for maintenance fluid or for just giving antibiotics or other intravenous medications, then generally we prefer 20 gauge. So 20 gauge most often you will see pink color, that you will see in your wards. Mostly the pink color 20 gauge is used. 22 small gauge, so obviously for pediatric patients, it's a blue color, very commonly used in pediatric patients and for newborns, neonates, or sometimes for infant We use 24 gauge, which is a yellow color cannula, and I think all of you must have used in during your pediatric postings. So coming back to the question was, they were asking the color of 22 gauge cannula. So obviously it will be blue. Question 3, for blood spillage in operation theatre, the disinfectant use is, the options are phenol, quaternary ammonium compound, and very commonly used quaternary ammonium compound, you know, is called as DA125, the brand name, then sodium hypochlorite and hydrogen peroxide. So as a rule, and there is no second thought, that if there is a blood spillage, it has to be cleaned with a significant concentration, that is 10% sodium hypochlorite. And this 10% sodium hypochlorite, you know, the person who is doing cleaning should be very cautious. He actually has to wear mask and has to wear gloves, plastic shoes, because that can cause damage to the skin, burns to the skin. So 10% is a quite significant concentration, but as a rule, there is a standard practice that blood stain should be cleaned. If there is a blood spillage, it should be cleaned by 10% sodium hypochlorite. There is no second thought about that. Other methods of cleaning, there are n number of solutions which are available, everyone claiming to be superior than other, but actually more or less all are equally good. But the usually used policies, but what other policies for floor cleaning and surface cleaning, I am telling, are not the standard ones defined that you have to do. Yes, for blood spillage, 10% sodium chloride is standard. There is no, I mean, nobody can change it. It's a standard policy. Floor cleaning, most commonly at the majority of the places, it is a 1% sodium hypochlorite which is used. 1% sodium hypochlorite, but in 1%. 1% concentration can cause damage, but very rare and very little, so that is most often used. Otherwise you can use quaternary ammonium compounds also, but cost wise this quaternary ammonium compounds DA125 was telling is very expensive. So considering the cost, and secondly they are moderate bactericidal, quaternary compounds are moderate bactericidal, while the sodium hypochlorite comes in the higher bactericidal bracket. So 1% sodium hypochlorite for surface cleaning. Surface means cleaning the OT table, anesthesia machine, OT lights, or your trolley. So surface cleaning, the most preferred is either alcohol based, they are definitely considered best, but practically not possible. Cost wise, if they becomes very expensive, and usage is also difficult, they get evaporated very fast. So most of the places we are using quaternary ammonium compound, which I told you is DA125. The most often use is DA125. So that's just a commercial name actually. So now coming to the next question. Pre-oxygenation before induction should be given for how much time? Now what the pre-oxygenation is, you all know, as the name clearly suggests. Pre-oxygenation means we are giving oxygen to the patient before induction of the anesthesia, and the aim for that is simply to replace nitrogen present in lungs with oxygen. So if you give 100% oxygen for 3 minutes, you can replace almost 95% of the nitrogen from lungs. Now whole of the lung is filled with oxygen, so if the patient sustains hypoxia, he will be able to sustain it for longer periods. And there are possibilities that you are not able to intubate the patient, and the worst to worst scenario is that you are not able to even intubate, ventilate the patient with bag and mask. Then in that case, definitely if there are more oxygen reserves in the body, and you know that the main oxygen reservoir of the body is our lungs, in the form of functional residual capacity. But in normal circumstances, functional residual capacity is around 2 liters or so, which only constitutes 21% of oxygen, so very little oxygen. Means just say around oxygen reserve for 2 minutes, because 250 ml is our oxygen requirement per minute. So we have 400 around or 500 ml of oxygen in the lungs, means the reservoir is just for 2 minutes. If you give 100% oxygen for 3 minutes, 95% of the nitrogen is nitrogen is removed from the lungs and filled with oxygen, means you have a reserve for around 7-8 minutes. So if you are not able to intubate, you are not able to ventilate the patient with bag and mask, patient may not undergo hypoxic brain damage, because you know that brain can easily sustain a hypoxia of around 5 minutes. So pre-oxygenation is a very, very mandatory part of anesthesia, and so you can say the aim of pre-oxygenation is to denitrogenate the patient, or simple words you can say to improve the oxygen reserve of the body. So it must be done before induction. Even if it is a life threatening emergency, means you have to induce the patient, patient is about to die, you cannot even afford 3 minutes wait period, severe fetal distress, umbilical cord collapse, you are giving GA, or patient have massive hemorrhage, so we have to induce. In that cases also, what we do as an alternative to pre-oxygenation, we ask the patient to take 4 to 5 full deep breaths with 100% oxygen. So that also replaces significant amount of nitrogen from the lungs. So pre-oxygenation has to be done routinely by giving 100% oxygen for 3 minutes. In case of life threatening severe emergencies where you do not have even 3 minutes, then the alternative is to ask the patient to take 4 to 5 breaths with 100% oxygen. So obviously answer would be 3 minutes. Then next question, a patient was treated for septicemia with norepinephrine infusion, which of the following best explain the benefit of norepinephrine? Obviously you are treating it, when you are treating the hypotension, obviously that should be best guided by increase in mean arterial pressure, and our target is always to keep mean arterial pressure above 65. When you are treating any hypotension, we should be guided by mean arterial pressure, and our target should be more than 65 mmHg. Although in these choices, increased urine output will be an excellent choice, excellent selection. If patient urine output is increasing, that means patient's cardiac output is increasing, patient is well maintaining the tissue perfusion, so urine has come to increase. But majority of the cases, what we have seen is, and you all must be knowing, that very often pre-renal azotemia, usually common is pre-renal azotemia shock, but this pre-renal azotemia is mostly ignored by the people in our country especially, and that get converted into renal azotemia. So urine output can be misguiding. So in that case, you just can't rely on urine output and keep on giving fluid or ionotropic support to the patient. Yes. So we actually initially go by mean arterial pressure. If our mean arterial pressure remains above say 65, so we are satisfied with that, and then if urine output is not increasing in spite of that, then we have to really do the renal function to see whether this pre-renal has got converted into renal azotemia. Then blood is stored in what for 35 days. The most commonly used, you know, in India is CDPA, that is citrate, dextrose, phosphate and adenine. So that is most often used. West mostly they are using Edsol or Nutrice. Yes, until few years back people were using CDPA. Now we can store blood for different periods with this different preservatives. With only CDP, without adenine, you are just able to store blood for 3 weeks. But if you add adenine, then you know that they can survive for longer periods, cells. So we can keep it for 35 days, 5 weeks. And Edsol and Nutrice are two main brand names, but the constituents are again same, CDPA, glutamine, some other nutrition parts are there. So with Edsol, Nutrice and Optisol, not I have seen, and maybe in only few countries it is being used, you can extend this for one more week, that is for around 6 weeks, 42 days. And you know that the volume in the Indian unit, Indian blood unit, total is 350 ml. Out of that 350 ml, 49 ml is CDPA. 300 ml is blood, 301 specifically, and 49 ml is the CDPA. Drugs used for anaphylactic shock. Yes, the most preferred drug is the adrenaline. Now the concentration of adrenaline or epinephrine, adrenaline used for shock is 1 in 1000. Subcutaneous, most often we give subcutaneous or you can give IM. In fact, nowadays people are preferring IM. Until few years back, they were in the opinion that IM causes muscle necrosis, so people were preferring subcutaneous. But as per newer guidelines, studies have shown that absorption of subcutaneous is comparatively poor, and you know that, you all must have, I don't know if you use or not, you must have seen majority of the staff, when you ask them to give subcutaneous injection, they give IM. And definitely IM absorption is faster compared to subcutaneous and more reliable. So now the current recommendation is more in favor of IM. So for anaphylaxis, IM route is preferred. Yes, subcutaneous can also be used, but preferred is definitely IM. And the IM concentration is 1 in 1000, means undiluted. The normal adrenaline ampule which is available is 1 in 1000. So undiluted, half ml. 1 ml is 1 milligram, so you can say 0.5 milligram, 0.5 ml or 0.5 milligram IM is the best, you can say, treatment for anaphylactic shock. Then in case of life-threatening emergencies, anaphylaxis is so severe that it has caused severe laryngospasm, bronchospasm, severe shock, then we can use other routes also, other rapid routes like IV. Or intraosseous, or even through endotracheal tube if you have intubated the patient. In those situations, the concentration will be 1 in 10,000. And that is what the concentration we are using in CPR, because in CPR we are giving IV, intraosseous and endotracheal in the same preference. Endotracheal most commonly used, you know, is the tibia. So actually the concentration of adrenaline depends on the route rather than the indication. So even for anaphylaxis, if you are giving IV, intraosseous or endotracheal, concentration will be 1 in 10,000. 10,000 pre-filled 1 in 10,000 syringes come, means they dilute 1 in 10 ml and pre-filled syringes are already available, but many places you will see that pre-filled is not available. So in that case, you have to take that 1 ml of adrenaline in 10 ml syringe, dilute it up to 10 and then give. Another use of adrenaline commonly used is to produce local vasoconstriction with local anesthetics, and with local anesthetic the concentration of adrenaline that is available is 1 in 2 lakhs. That is a standard, 1 in 2 lakhs. Now coming to the next question, a nurse should perform suctioning of an intubated patient for how many seconds? Yes, good question. Actually, maximum permissible apnea time as a rule for any damn thing is 15 seconds. And that is why all our ventilators automatically by default, they are set up in an apnea backup time of 15 seconds. Means if the patient stops ventilation, patient is on spontaneous ventilation with assisted ventilation from a ventilator, or if the patient is on spontaneous ventilation with just ventilator is giving pressure support, and the patient due to any reason stops breathing, goes in apnea, automatically every ventilator after 15 seconds will start delivering its breath. So very simple line is, anything should not stop apnea breathing for more than 15 seconds. So even if you are doing suctioning, then also it should not take more than 15 seconds. So apnea time is standard 15 seconds. And yes, then BLS components are all except AED, PAD, ventilation with mask and ventilation with intubation. You know, CPR basically has three components. basic life support, advanced life support and post cardiac arrest care. So CPR is done under three heads. Basic life support, whether you are doing CPR with BLS or ALS, the management is simply ABCD: airway, breathing, circulation and defibrillation. Now depending on the circumstances, you may do CPR with BLS or you can directly start with ALS. So normally majority of the cases you will be starting CPR with basic life support, and as soon as your equipments are ready you shift over to ALS. But in hospital settings, particularly in ICU where everything is monitored and immediately you detect and all equipments are readily hand available, or in operation theatres also, we can start directly with ALS also. So now the differences between BLS and ALS is, now BLS ABCD, airway, breathing, circulation and defibrillation, are now simply numbered as 1, 2, 3, 4, while ALS ABCD are simply numbered as ABCD. Why they have done it so? Because previously, you know, BLS ABCD used to be called as primary ABCD and ALS ABCD used to be called as secondary ABCD. So that confusion was always there. So they have removed those confusions. Simply, if somebody has written 1, 2, 3, 4, that means he or she has done CPR under BLS. If somebody has written ABCD, means CPR was done under ALS. Now in BLS, airway is managed with the manual method. And what is the manual method? Triple manual, you all know: head tilt, chin lift and jaw thrust. Head tilt means extend the neck, chin lift, lift the chin, jaw thrust means anterior displacement of the mandible. And this obviously is done to prevent the tongue fall, because the most common cause of airway obstruction is tongue fall. And very interesting fact there, so is not only the actually tongue fall, it is the epiglottis also which falls back. Recent studies have shown that in studies they found that epiglottis even is more responsible for airway obstruction than tongue fall. So these maneuvers will also relieve the epiglottis obstruction other than the tongue obstruction. So in basic life support, airway will be managed with the manual method, that is triple manual I told you, while in advanced life support it will be managed with the help of equipments, and the most basic equipment you know to prevent tongue fall is Goodell's airway. You just simply place that airway and in the oropharynx, so that will prevent tongue falling back on posterior pharyngeal wall. Then breathing by bag and mask is the part of basic life support. Anything beyond bag and mask, and mouth to mouth, you know, for common men now they have disgraced the use of mouth to mouth breathing for common men. So the most basic method you can say of breathing is becoming is bag and mask. Anything beyond bag and mask, which could be your endotracheal tube, laryngeal mask, airway, combi tube, they will be classified as advanced life support. And you know that the best method to accomplish breathing is by intubation, endotracheal tube. Circulation in both is managed by cardiac massage. Circulation is more managed by cardiac compression. Now defibrillation by automatic external defibrillator is a part of basic life support, while defibrillation with manual defibrillators is a part of advanced life support. And why it is so? As the name suggests, automatic external defibrillators means they are automatic, and I think majority of you must have seen them. You just switch them on, place the electrodes over the chest, automatically they will diagnose the rhythm, and if they found the rhythm to be shockable, they will select the energy and give shock, and they will keep on guiding also. They are they have voice mechanism also. So by voice mechanism they keep on telling also the rhythm is shockable, now we are giving shock, stand clear from the bed. So they guide. Now since the job of a person in AED is to place the electrodes and switch them on, that's it. So since they can automatically deliver and they can be used by a layman, and that is why in 2015 guidelines they changed the name of these AEDs to PAD, public access defibrillators, means they can be used by public, and since they can be used by public, so they are the part of basic life support. And now you see them, even in India you can see them commonly on airports. West you go, you can see them in the market or railway stations, streets, even you will find in some places on streets they are also there. So since they can be used by public, common men, so they are the part of basic life support. Manual defibrillators which we are using in hospitals, you know, there you have to diagnose the rhythm, you have to charge them, you have to give shock. So they can only be used by medical personnel, so obviously they has to be a part of advanced life support. Not a triage color, blue, black, red and green. Now what actually triage is? Triage means where the trials will be utilized. Triage is utilized for usually mass casualties, disasters, where patient load is more and staff load is less, or for some casualties also, if they have a very high input of the patients, they also develop the triage system. So in triage means segregation, simply segregating the patient into the categories on the basis of their clinical condition, so that we don't waste resources. Means for a minor injury you cannot attend the patient with that much vigorous and all force you can use if there are other patients who are suffering from life threatening injuries. So the patient when arrive in an emergency room, they have to triage, so that staff accordingly can start acting on them. So usually there are 4, but 5 also they have added as in white. So as soon as the patient arrives, there is a triage area where they will put a band. Now band vary from hospital to hospital. Every hospital has a right also to form its bands. It can be hand band, it can be a eye card like band, anyway, any method, and it should be both sided, so that even if you get flip side on the other side, you can see the same text. So usually it should be both sided. So we give black band to the patients who are definitely going to die. Expectant means going to die. You really can't do anything about them, they are going to die. You have to just take care of their main grievance, that is pain. So just take care of pain until they die. So they are categorized in the black triage tag. Red are the patients who actually require most of the resources, means they are suffering from life threatening injuries, but if managed immediately can be saved. So your maximum resources are to be used for the triage patients with the red tag with them. Then come yellow. Yellow means they are having injuries, but they are not life threatening. So we can just give them the basic management, and then we can segregate them in yellow, means we can look later. Green, very minor injuries, minimal injuries, no more attention is required. First, if we clear red or yellow patients, if have less resources, then we can look at the green triage, they can still easily wait. White, they have added extra, and white means this patient is having insignificant injury and they actually don't require doctor consultation, you can just advise them and go home. So dismiss means they don't even require medical treatment. Then injuries to the children in bus accident, maximum priority. I mean, it's a very simple question, everybody knows that nothing is more important than breathing, and that is why this advanced trauma life support mnemonic is ABCDE, means first priority is the airway. Obviously if you are not able to manage airway and breathing, I just now also I told you that brain cannot sustain hypoxia for more than 5-6 minutes. So if you are not able to maintain the oxygen saturation, then there is no point. So definitely the top priority will be airway and breathing. Then second comes is the once you have secured the air vent breathing, then comes the management of the shock. Means patient is in shock. Just I like to try want to differentiate one thing here. If the patient comes in cardiac arrest, in trauma patient can also come in cardiac arrest, then the sequence will be followed for CPR, and CPR sequence you know is CAB, not ABC. CAB. CAB means first you have to give 30 compressions over a period of 20 seconds, then go to airway and breathing. But majority of the trauma patients, they will come without cardiac arrest, in severe shock but without cardiac arrest. In those cases, this ATLS protocol is applicable, that is airway breathing and then circulation. So just as handle your air vent breathing, but patient is having palpable pulse, means not in cardiac arrest, then once you have managed air vent breathing, and then you start managing your shock. And in a trauma patient, the cause of shock should be considered hemorrhagic until proved otherwise. So you have to manage the hemorrhagic shock. Once you have stabilized this emergencies, then you can look at the disability. Disability means you completely look injuries from head to toe and exposure. And I think regarding this disability and exposure, this orthopedic people or surgery people will be able to go in much details about these, maybe in your other classes. Then patient with renal calculi given a drug with antagonistic action at mu and agonistic action at kappa. The drug is opioids, you all know, are classified as pure agonist, pure antagonist and mixed opioids. Pure agonist, as the name suggests, means they are agonist at all receptors, mainly acting on mu. And the prototype of pure agonist is morphine. Morphine, other may be pethidine, and you know that nowadays we are using the newer pure agonist. And most commonly used newer pure agonist which we are using is fentanyl. Fentanyl, India fentanyl is used. L-fentanyl, su-fentanyl, remifentanyl are the other pure agonist which can be used. Pure antagonist, as the name suggests, means they are agonistic at all receptors. They will antagonize the action of pure agonist. So obviously they also mainly act on mu receptors. Now comes the agonist antagonist. Now agonist antagonist used in India, there are many other also, but most commonly used is pentazocine, fortuin. All of you must have used fortuin phenargan combination, very popular in India. Pentazocine, then butorphanol is also used, not as popular as fortuin, but butorphanol is also used, and then nalbuphine. Recently some company has launched nalbuphine also, and the fourth one is buprenorphine, which has very limited role, but yet still it is sometimes used, buprenorphine. So these four mixed opioids are generally used in India. Now this mixed agonist are unique. Mixed agonist means agonist antagonist. As the name suggests, agonist antagonist means they will be agonist up to a certain dose, and after certain dose the agonist action finishes and the antagonist action begins. Now let's take the example of pentazocine, fortuin. Up to 70 milligram it behaves like an agonist, producing agonistic actions, but once the dose crosses the 70, the agonistic action finishes and the antagonistic action begins. Same with the buprenorphine. Up to 300 micrograms it behaves like agonist, after that it start behaving like antagonist. Now these mixed opioids, they are agonist and antagonist at different receptors. Like all these agonist antagonist, all agonist antagonist except buprenorphine and digoxin, except buprenorphine and digoxin, are agonist at kappa and antagonist at mu. Buprenorphine and digoxin, they are agonist at all receptors, mainly in mu in low doses, and become antagonist at the same receptors in higher doses. Means simply you can say in low doses they behave like pure agonist, and higher doses they behave like pure antagonist. Now what is the reason for this complication? As a matter of common sense also, agonistic action has a plateau phase. agonistic action has a plateau phase, means maximum analgesia as well as maximum side effect, that is respiratory depression, will be seen only till the agonistic action is maximum, means with pantazosin the maximum respiratory depression you see is will be at 70 milligram. After that you will not see any respiratory depression because the antagonistic action begins. Same with buprenorphine, up to 300 microgram it will show you the maximum respiratory depression. After that, even if you give more dose, it will antagonize the respiratory depression because it is agonistin and antagonistic at the same receptors. So nutshell, you can say this process is actually called as ceiling, roof, means the ceiling has been achieved to all actions, not only respiratory depression, to all actions including analgesia. So but from practical point of view, more important is respiratory depression, because you know that respiratory depression is the main cause of death in opioid poisoning. So the most important, simple, you can say one line characteristic of this mixed opioids is they exhibit ceiling to respiratory depression. I just now told you ceiling is actually to all agonistic actions, and that ceiling will be achieved at 70 milligram for example with pentazosin and with 300 microgram with buprenorphine. After that, whatever dose you give, risk of respiratory depression will not be there. So there is a ceiling, roof effect. So that is the biggest, you can say, beauty of these mixed opioids, that they don't produce life threatening respiratory depression at higher doses. So now coming to the question, drug which is agonist at kappa and antagonist at mu is a mixed opioid, and that will be pentazosin. Now balance resuscitation means, now there is a concept that you can say management of resuscitation has been changed. Resuscitation means we are talking of the management of the hemorrhagic shock. As per the new guidelines, very latest guidelines, the two most important basic components of shock management, and I am talking of hemorrhagic shock, the basic two new changing concepts of this resuscitation is hypotensive resuscitation and hemostatic resuscitation. As the word clearly suggests, hypotensive resuscitation means you are not achieving the normal blood pressure, your target value is the normal, not the normal blood pressure, it should be low. Why? Reason is very clear. In a hemorrhagic shock patient, if you suddenly increase the blood pressure to the normal level, the effect of tamponade will be lost. Blood clots, if you increase the blood pressure, that tamponade effect of clot will go, and that increase in blood pressure will lead to further bleeding. So very simple. Secondly, they say that since the clotting factors are also lost during the hemorrhagic shock, so if you give more fluids, there occur dilutional coagulopathies. So they bought the concept of hypotensive resuscitation, and studies have very well proven that the patients who have normal blood pressure and patients who have hypotensive blood pressure, hypotensive resuscitation, they performed far better in morbidity as well as mortality. Now what is the definition of hypotensive resuscitation? Definition of hypotensive resuscitation is to maintain systolic blood pressure between 80 to 100 mmHg. 80 to 100 mmHg, although they say we should go by mean arterial pressure, because it is not only the systolic blood pressure which defines morbidity and mortality, that we will discuss in shock index also later. But so they say mean arterial pressure, and mean arterial pressure, our aim should be to keep mean arterial pressure around 65 to 70 mmHg. But achieving mean arterial pressure sometimes become difficult. So they say hypotensive resuscitation broadly means maintaining systolic blood pressure between 80 to 100. So that is the immediate goal. Shock management, you all must have read and must be knowing, that shock management is always divided into early goals of resuscitation and late goals of resuscitation. Early goals means maintain hypotensive resuscitation, means maintaining systolic blood pressure between 80 to 100. Then second concept they found is that bleeding sometimes don't get continuous, studies have shown, because enough, particularly massive hemorrhages, not minor hemorrhages. In massive hemorrhages, they found that there is significant loss of coagulation factors also, including platelets. So a concept of preemptive coagulopathy resuscitation also came, hemostatic resuscitation came, where they are giving 1:1:1. PRBC, one FFP and one unit of platelets. Then the concept changed, they brought it to 1:1, one PRBC, one FFP, two FFP, fresh frozen plasma and one platelet. But later studies also found that this preemptive hemostatic resuscitation also unnecessarily lead to transfusion of blood products. So now they say the recent concept is that you have to see the coagulation parameters. So as a part of ongoing resuscitation, you immediately get the PT-APTT done. Although you know that APTT or PT or INR are also not considered as reliable as thromboelastography. So the best monitoring for coagulation status is thromboelastography. But thromboelastography report will come around in half an hour, but you know that also is available at very few centers in India. So we are still going by PT, APTT and INR, they say also. If you don't have facility for thromboelastography, you can go for PT, APTT and INR. So you get these results, and if you find any abnormality and also platelet count, obviously as a also platelet count. And accordingly, depending on the values of your coagulation deficiencies, you can keep on replacing either with platelets or fresh frozen plasma. So this is called as hemostatic resuscitation. And this concept of hypotensive resuscitation and hemostatic resuscitation is called as balanced resuscitation. Means we are keeping balance in everything. We are neither giving excessive fluid nor we are giving less fluids. And we are also maintaining the other components of the blood. So that is called as hemostatic resuscitation. So this concept is a new concept and that is called as balanced resuscitation. So now coming back to the question. So balanced resuscitation will be D, choice will be D, restrictive use of fluids for hypotensive resuscitation and simultaneous we give blood products also. What I was talking of, modified shock index, they saw the mean guidance of shock in shock will be, I told you, mean arterial pressure, we go by mean arterial pressure, or you can go by systolic blood pressure also, and heart rate, because you know that the first symptom of usually shock is tachycardia. So they derive an index to find the prognosis in resuscitation, predictor of resuscitation. And you know, all of you must be knowing that the shock index is a very old concept where heart rate is divided by systolic blood pressure. So that is a very old concept of shock index, heart rate divided by systolic blood pressure. And they found, and many years they have used shock index to see the prognosis of resuscitation, morbidity as well as mortality. But I told you that studies have shown that it is not only the systolic blood pressure which plays an important part in predicting the prognosis after shock. Diastolic also has a very important role. Why? Very well you know, coronary filling occurs in diastolic blood pressure, and that is why you know, as per new CPR guidelines monitoring, one of the parameter to see your successful CPR is diastolic blood pressure. Diastolic blood pressure should not be less than 20, then only you can say your CPR is successful, otherwise it is totally unsuccessful. So that clearly shows that role of diastolic blood pressure was also very good. So that is why they derived modified shock index, which included mean arterial pressure in place of systolic blood pressure. So it will be heart rate divided by mean arterial blood pressure, and mean arterial, you know, is includes both systolic as well as diastolic. So now prognostication of a shock, morbidity and mortality is determined by the modified shock index. So coming back to the question, so it will be heart rate divided by mean arterial pressure, that is choice is A, heart rate divided by mean arterial pressure, choice A. Drug used for induction of anesthesia. Actually, for induction, most commonly, almost always, in fact, we are using propofol. For certain indications other than propofol, we can use thiopentone. That details will not discuss. But yes, for certain conditions, we can still use thiopentone, but mostly, almost always, we are using propofol. Other drug which is used for induction is etomidate for cardiac patients because it is cardiac stable, or ketamine. Ketamine also have certain of it indications where it is being used, but that list is very long, so we will not go in that much details. So these are actually the four drugs which are being used for induction. Opioids and benzodiazepine, they can be used for induction, but not because the induction dose is too high, very high, so that is why we don't use them. But yes, among these choices we have no option, so it will be lorazepam. So benzodiazepines can be used for induction, but in very high doses which are actually not desirable, so we are generally not using them. Dexmedetomidine is used for sedation, difficult to use for induction, because if that can also be used for induction, but doses will be too high, that can cause cardiac arrest, acyclic, complete acyclic. So obviously cannot be used, and obviously neostigmine or bupivacaine, neostigmine is only acting on neuromuscular junction, and bupivacaine is a local anesthetic. So question is there, but I won't say it's a good question, but yes, it's the question, so we have to answer accordingly. So among these, the choices left only is lorazepam, but I told you also that benzodiazepines are not suitable for induction. A patient is intubated and on ventilation in ICU. His relative rushed to tell the treating doctor that the patient has removed endotracheal tube from his mouth. What should be the next step? This is called as spontaneous extubation, or in fact say self-extubation. The more appropriate term is self-extubation. Self-extubation actually many times, not always, many times it acts as blessing in disguise. When the patient is extubating, so there can be two reasons. Either the patient is conscious enough to remove the tube, stable enough to remove the tube, or secondly, the patient is irritable due to head injury, or sometimes the presence of Ryan's tube, or to the some drugs, he or she is in delirium like atropine. So in that delirium or in that irritation, he or she can remove endotracheal tube. So both situations are there. So we always say self extubation as blessing in disguise. First means if the patient has removed endotracheal tube by himself or herself, so you stand there, look at the oxygen saturation, respiratory pattern of the patient. If the patient saturation is maintained, or patient you can say respiratory breathing is almost normal, then means patient has automatically weaned himself or herself. So just observe for some time, continuously observe, stand by the end of the patient bed, stand there only and look for the oxygen saturation and breathing pattern. Yes, many times we are lucky enough that that automatically act as a weaning process. So patient maintains oxygen saturation, maintaining breathing, there is no harm, just wait and watch. Maximum you can supplement with the oxygen. If saturation is a little on the margin side, you can supplement with the oxygen and observe. So that is the best policy. Yes, if patient desaturate any time, immediately start ventilation with bag and mask, and by the time your tube will be ready, and immediately reintubate the patient, sedate and reintubate the patient. So among these choices, now you look at the question. So the first, the best will be SS for spontaneous breathing and oxygen saturation obviously. And if that is okay, we can go ahead. If no, anytime we are standing there, we will get intubation and intubation cart, trolley, everything ready. We will immediately re-intubate the patient if patient desaturates. So the best choice will be A. Maximum oxygenation. You know that oxygen delivery devices has been classified as high flow systems and low flow systems. High flow system mainly include Venturi mask. Rest all oxygen delivery devices which you know are nasal prong, nasal cannula or simple oxygen mask, they are classified as low flow systems. High flow system, there are other also high flow blenders, high flow nebulizers, but they are rarely used. So high flow mainly with Venturi mask. The advantage of high flow systems is they are very accurate in terms of oxygen delivery. The scope of error is not more than 2%, means if you start 50%, they will keep on continuously giving 50%. But low flow systems, the major disadvantage is that they are variable performance, means their performance will keep on varying with the changes in the patient respiratory parameters. So they can't be very reliable in terms of delivery of oxygen. Variation can be even up to 10%, 20%. But the main advantage of low flow system is, since they are low flow devices, so they are very well tolerated by the patient. High flow systems deliver high flow, and in Venturi mask this high flow is passed through a narrow hole. So the pressure also increases. So if the patient is conscious and continuously he receives high flow at high pressure, that can cause significant discomfort to the patient. So patient compliance and discomfort is the major limitation of high flow systems. So but the advantage of high flow system that Venturi mask is that we can give up to 60%. So high flow systems will be useful for the patients where accuracy in oxygen is more important and we need more delivery of oxygen, more concentration of oxygen for the patient. So we will be using Venturi mask, but that I told you the main disadvantage is that they can cause significant discomfort. Low flow systems mainly used, you know, is nasal prongs, all of you must have used, and the simple oxygen mask. Now the maximum oxygen which you can deliver with the nasal cannula is 44%, and with oxygen mask you can maximum deliver is around 60%, but that is also if you increase the flow to little higher, around 10 liters, 8 to 10 liters. So that is the maximum which we can give with all these available devices. But few years back they devised a concept, they found that if a with a normal mask, if you attach a reservoir bag, and I think many of you must have seen some oxygen masks come attached with a reservoir bag, same like Ambu bag, there is a reservoir bag. If that bag is there, if oxygen can get accumulated there, then you can deliver even up to 100 to, they say 80 to 100%, but 100 is actually not possible, but yes, say somewhere between 80 to 100% you can deliver. So that is why now at many places, or majority of the places, we have start preferring this non rebreathing mask with reservoir with the Venturi mask, because Venturi, I told you, very high pressure comes, so discomfort, so that discomfort can be avoided and still we can give higher concentration. So now this mask with oxygen reservoir is even most of the time is preferred over Venturi mask. So now coming back to the question, so obviously maximum oxygenation can be provided by face mask with rebreathing bag. Now least sensitive to local anesthetics. I think over last 10 years, I don't think there has been any, I mean any other part where every 4-5 years you see a sequence getting changed. All of you know from our college days also, we have been told that fiber diameter is the most sensitive, so the least fiber diameter or the thinnest fiber diameter nerve fiber will be blocked earlier than thick diameter fibers. So the sequence used to be CBA, because C is the thinnest, B is moderate, and then A is the thickest fibers. So CBA has been the trend for years and years. Then they found that it's not only the fiber diameter, myelination also plays a very important part. So this sequence got changed. The myelinated fiber will be blocked earlier if the difference in diameter is not significant. So the concept of first A gamma getting blocked, then A delta, then B, then C, and then A alpha and beta came. But then they found that the number of nodes of Renivar are also important in myelination. Physiological, then recently they found anatomical location and physiological considerations, including pH of that area, that also plays a role. So that also again changed, and recently they have very simplified. Now it is the ABC, and obviously it was an expected question because that's again a change. So A, and among A, yes, if you get the distribution of A also, then it will be A gamma to be blocked first, like earlier, A delta also, and A alpha and beta are blocked simultaneously after A delta, and then B fiber and then C. And if they don't give sub classification of this A, then simply the sequence will be ABC. So that is again a very later change. So among the chances question they have asked, least sensitive. So obviously as per new guidelines, C will be the least sensitive. Then female in labor room with narcotic poisoning, which emergency drug has to be kept ready? Obviously very easy question. I think the most easiest question among these will be this. Naloxone is the most commonly used antagonist for opioid poisoning, and naloxone obviously will be required if mother is having narcotic poisoning, otherwise that can cause severe fetal respiratory depression. But naloxone you have to be cautious. Life threatening emergencies including ventricular fibrillation and cardiac arrest can occur with naloxone. So naloxone should be given slowly in increments, not as a rapid bolus. The patient of RTA who is conscious, what should not be done? Question is again more or less as a matter of common sense. Any patient, as a rule, simple, any trauma patient should be considered to be having a spine injury until put otherwise. Spine means it could be lumbar thoracic spine or it will be cervical spine. So you know that a very standard is all unconscious patients should be considered to be having cervical spine injury until put otherwise. For conscious patients, we have to believe that they also have a spinal injury until put otherwise. So the most important thing is don't move the patient. The word is very simple word is, patient should be transferred en bloc till spinal injury has been ruled out. That's a very simple, and that also makes a common sense also. So obviously you have to en bloc means you have to strap the patient before shifting. So strap head, strap thorax, strap legs, and then en bloc strap the patient to your block, and then shift en bloc to the stretcher. So that is the basic principle. So obviously among these choices, the best choices will be roll the patient. You cannot think of rolling the patient of the trauma until and unless you have ruled out the spine injuries. Now the best reliable indicator in fluid resuscitation. I was expecting this question, but I still don't agree that the choice in these choices will not be stroke volume variation, because it's a memory based question. So the question which I received in memory based, where I did not find this choice of a stroke volume variation, which I think it is little surprising and I won't believe also. So maybe somebody in the memory based question have missed it. Otherwise I was expecting 100% this question in any of the exam, and still you will keep on expecting in this this question in other exams also, that now they say fluid monitoring should be best done by dynamic parameters, dynamic cardiac parameters, and dynamic cardiac parameters are stroke volume variation, pulse pressure variation, cardiac output, and pulmonary artery occlusion pressure. So fluid, they so say should be guided by dynamic parameters, but still most often at majority of the centers we are giving fluid as per CVP. Why? Because technically easy, because to measure the dynamic parameters, to measure stroke volume variation, you have to do echocardiography. So everybody is not expert, and bedside echocardiography or emergency echocardiography is not available in majority of the centers. So we are still majority of the places we are still giving fluid by a static parameter, that is CVP. However, I told you static parameters are not preferred, it should be given by dynamic parameters, and among dynamic parameters the most preferred is stroke volume variation. What does it mean? As the name suggests, stroke volume variation means variations seen in stroke volume during inspiration and expiration. This variation should be less than 10 to 15%. If it is more than 15%, means patient is fluid deficient. Keep on giving fluids till this variation become less than 15%. So that is considered as best. Coming back to the question, now best reliable or most reliable indicator in fluid excursion, yes, definitely among these choices it will be CVP. It will be CVP, but CVP also has certain limitations. It is a static parameter. Patients with COPD or asthma, they already have CVP, so that can misguide us also. Like in cardiac tamponade also CVP can also misguide us. So CVP have certain limitations, but yes, among these choices it will be CVP. Second thing somebody can ask about is mean arterial pressure. So can't we go guided by the mean arterial pressure? Yes, mean arterial pressure is a very good indicator that patient is responding to fluid, no doubt about that. If the patient is responding to fluid by increasing the mean arterial pressure, means the patient is need to be given fluids. But the problem comes is if the patient is not responding, patient BP is not responding to fluids, that doesn't mean that we will keep on giving fluids, the patient may go in pulmonary edema. So we have to also know that how much fluid we can give, and after that much fluid, how much fluid the patient will be able to tolerate. We have to create a balance, and after that, even if you are giving enough fluid, CVP has increased and BP is not increasing, that means patient require inotropic support. We have to add noradrenaline, dopamine, whatever you want to use. So that should be guided by, that is why they say these all problems are ruled out with dynamic parameters, stroke volume variation. But if that choice is not there, which is still I am not ready to believe that choice will not be there. I think there was some problem in memory. One choice could have been stroke volume variation. So yes, among these choices, we have no option but to go for CVP. Now preoperative checklist does not include, again it does make a matter of very common sense, patient oral consent have no value. Oral consent have no value, patient can deny it. It should be written and it should be informed consent. Not only written consent, informed means everything has been explained to the patient in his or her words. And that is what commonly the patients come in, if there is a litigation, they say we are being asked to sign a paper and we don't know what was there, we just signed it. So it should be informed consent, and if it is something serious, like you are expecting serious complication, including say patient is very vulnerable for MI or something, then it should actually be written in the patient hand, in his own handwriting, whether it is Hindi or whatever language he or she understand, then that has a value. So oral consent has no value in medical legal field. So that again makes a very this question to be a part of a common sense. Now there is actually a checklist which is given by WHO. This is a WHO checklist. This is a standard checklist. I think those who have done OT postings would have seen this surgical safety checklist, and it is mandatory to be filled before induction of anesthesia, before incision, and before patient is shifted. So it has three parts. But obviously you, that time in OT you are always focusing more in the procedures rather than all these things, but these things are very important from medico legal point of view. So mainly as a matter of common sense, it mainly involves, most important is patient identity. So the wrong site, wrong patient is not get operated by chance. Second main is the site. Very popular case, you know, 1 year back, where two of our orthopedicians in one of a hospital in Delhi got suspending for operating on the wrong side of the foot. So site is very important. then certain patients, important conditions including history of allergy or patient, how much blood the patient is going to require, whether that is properly available or not, or anesthesia machine checked. These are other components which can go through. It's available everywhere in the WHO surgical safety checklist. If you go any of the site, you can download it. And I think that should be there the last question. But yes, you have quite significant number of questions this time related to trauma, ALS, ALS, anesthesia, critical care. So definitely they are focusing more. Still, if you have any doubt, I think you can note my email. You can mail me if still there is any other doubt. So it is Dr. Yadav, Yadav, Ajay, Ajay, at rediffmail.com. Dr. Yadav Ajay at rediffmail.com. So you can mail me also anytime.